be speaking about robot kinematic analysis to you today. Okay, so kinematic analysis, as you know, is basically a study of motion without regard to the forces which cause it. You all studied, hopefully, kinematics. So there are two problems that are encountered in robotics. The first one is robot forward kinematics, and that is if you are given a robot mechanism, whatever the configuration is, joints, links, okay, and you know everything about the geometry of it, then if you are given all the joint positions, that means the joint angles for each of the revolute axes, and if you had prismatic axis, then what is the offset distance? If those are known, then we want to find out where the wrist of the robot is. Okay, so that is called the forward kinematic problem. Similarly, many times you need to know what the robot should be doing, given that you want to reach an end point or the wrist point or the tool point. And there it is the inverse kinematic problem. You're given the space location and the orientation in which your wrist should be, and then you want to know what should be the joint angles. And that is, it's a harder problem. And in fact, there are no, the inverse kinematic problem is a harder problem. And there are, in general, there are no solutions if you had arbitrary robot, or there could be multiple solutions. But for most robots which are developed for the industry, the configurations are selected such that the inverse kinematic problem can be solved in the closed form. Then apart from kinematic analysis, you have, of course, the static analysis, where you would like to know the forces on each joint, if the wrist forces are given, forces and movements, I mean, and also the dynamic analysis, where the robot is executing some motion and there are acceleration, decelerations in the robot. So basically, when we deal with robotics, we are dealing with spatial, which means three-dimensional kinematics. Okay, because we need to reach any place in three dimensions, and also the fact that we want to be able to reach with any orientation. So that makes the problem much harder, because planar problems, okay, have motion in parallel planes only. So that is a whole lot of simpler problem. A planar problem is a much simpler problem in terms of maths, because all the rotational axes of the links are perpendicular to the plane of motion of the links, which means that if you have any rotations, okay, you can consider them in any order, for example. Whereas in the spatial kinematic case, you need to maintain the order of rotation. I will illustrate that. If you look at this diagram here, let us look at this frame here. This is the universal frame, and there are two rotations we desire, one about the y-axis and one about the x-axis. If you look at that, I start from here. I have one sequence in which I do the y rotation first, and you'll see that from going from here to here, I have performed 90 degrees of rotation about the y-axis, and a flat piece which was aligned like this earlier now looks like this. And then I execute the x rotation about the x-axis by 90 degrees, and I end up with a position of the object like this. If I did the other sequence, that means I did the x rotation first, then from this initial same position, I come to this position after doing 90 degrees of x rotation. And then when I do rotation about the y-axis, I end up with a different orientation of the object. Therefore, this is the problem that one has to keep in mind. This is the problem that corresponds to basically matrix multiplication not being commutative. In the plane we are talking about rotations about the z-axis alone, and therefore if I have, let's say, two rotations, minus 15 degrees and 45 degrees, it doesn't matter which sequence I carry them out. I start out with an object like this, then I do 45 degrees rotation, which means if you look at the direction of the rotation, it's about positive z-axis I rotate, that means counterclockwise in this case, and I get 45 degrees rotation from the original position, which comes brings me here, and then minus 15 degrees rotation, undoes some of the rotation. And if I did the other way round, first doing minus 15 degrees, then followed by 45 degrees positive, then I end up in the same position. Okay, that is only because of the fact that all the axes of rotation are all aligned in the z direction. Okay, as I already mentioned, we need 6 degrees of freedom for a general robot to be able to reach a point in any orientation. And basically, in most of the robots, we use simple joints like revolute joints and prismatic joints. So we come to the problem of how do we describe position and orientation. We all know that if you want a point in space, then we can describe it by a position, the coordinates of the point with respect to some coordinate system. Or equivalently, we can have a vector which has three components representing the same three. When it comes to orientation, now we talk about orientation obviously of a rigid body, whereas we talk of position of a point. So if you want to talk about position of a rigid body, we have to identify a point first on the rigid body and then say, okay, I'm going to mean this is the point that of interest to me. Orientation, on the other hand, pertains to the rigid body itself. Now I can describe the orientation of the rigid body by choosing a point on it, describing its position, and then choosing some other points and telling something about the positions of those. Then I should be able to identify the orientation of that particular object. I can also do it by having three angles describe, with three angles describing rotation about some axes. Okay, they could be fixed axes, they could be the axes which are obtained after rotation of a coordinate frame, and those kind of angles can also suffice. So you have two descriptions, two type of descriptions, roll pitch yaw description or Euler angle description of orientation. We won't deal too much with this, we won't have time to deal with it, but basically roll pitch and yaw description is with respect to fixed reference frames. When the reference frame remains fixed with respect to the object, not with respect to the object, but with respect to the universal frame, then when we describe rotations about different axes, then we have the roll pitch y, RPY description. And if we describe the rotations about rotated frame of reference, then you get the Euler angle representation. What we will be concentrating more on is the third type, which is a rotation matrix. Okay, just a notation, note on notation, we are going to use small letters for scalars, capital letters for matrices and coordinate frames, and we are going to have a whole lot of prefixes, which means pre-superscript and pre-subscript, leading superscript and leading subscript. Leading superscript will refer to the reference coordinate frame with respect to which the motion is being described. And leading subscript will refer to the frame of interest that we are talking about. What are we talking about? Motion of what? Orientation of what? Etc. Now the trailing superscript is only going to be used for matrix operations like transposition and inverse of a matrix. And the trailing subscript is a descriptor. So what are, again, it's similar to the leading subscript, but can describe more. You can identify a particular point, etc. Hat quantities above the letter will mean that it's a unit vector, which means the magnitude of the vector is unity. So if you look at the examples here, this A, that is leading superscript, P, B origin, B org. So B org is the point we are talking about. P will refer typically to a position type of, just a point at the origin of, say, coordinate system B. But we are looking at the position in coordinate system A. So the leading superscript is very important, essential. Similarly, if you look at the second example here, I have B should have been just directly below it, but there was some problem in putting it like that. But what it means is, with respect to A, I'm looking at the rotation matrix R of A coordinate system B. Okay, and I'm looking at the inverse of that matrix, so that there is a minus 1 coming as a trailing superscript. Okay, keeping that in mind, now looking at translation and rotation or position and orientation, simple problem is, you know, given a point, you have the three components R1, R2, R3, which are the projections of this endpoint on the x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. Okay. Now, if you want to talk about orientation, what we will do is, on an object, the object's orientation that we are trying to talk about, we will fix a coordinate frame to that. Then we can talk about the orientation of the coordinate frame in the original coordinate frame, and that will tell us about the orientation or rotation of this coordinate frame with respect to the other one. And the way we can do this is simply by looking at the three axes here, xb hat, yb hat and zb hat are the coordinate system whose orientation I am trying to determine in the original coordinate system, which is, well, let's say coordinate system A, which is xa hat, ya hat and za hat. And the same three green lines I have shown in the original way, then you can see that each of these three unit vectors have projections on the x, y and z plane. Okay, so the components of each of these unit vectors can be known. So we basically have orientation of three points now, three vectors. So we can describe the orientation of an object by having three position vectors. All right, so we can write this as a rotation matrix consisting of three vectors. Rotation matrix A, B, R, which means I am looking at the orientation of B, with respect to A, and it consists of three unit vectors, XB with respect to A hat, YB with respect to A hat, and ZB with respect to A hat. Three unit vectors having components as described in this picture here. Okay, of course, I know that orientation can be described by three angles, three numbers. Now I have here nine numbers. So there is a lot of redundancies here. They are not independent. They are unit vectors, for example. So therefore, the sum of the squares of the components are one. So there are equations like this, and there are the fact that these axes are perpendicular to each other. So these three unit vectors are not just any three unit vectors, but they are perpendicular to each other. Therefore, the dot products of these are zero. So you have three relationships which are talking about the magnitude of these three vectors, and three relationships which are talking about the orthogonality of these vectors. So this rotation matrix then can describe the orientation for me. Is everyone convinced about that? Okay, it may not be the most succinct way of writing it, that is agreed, but it is convenient way. Yes. Yeah.
As a hypotenuse of the cube you are describing.
Uh-huh.
Can that hypotenuse be used for the orientation also?
It is being used for the orientation, but this is only one of the axes, right? A object. You are saying the object is a cubical object in which this is the vector.
Hypotenuse is, can be considered as one of the orientation considering factor.
Yeah, but it is not uniquely defining that object, because you take the hypotenuse. That orientation being known, you can rotate the object about that itself, and the vector will not change. Right? So it's not sufficient. Okay. So now when we want to describe, oftentimes we are going to talk about these frames attached to rigid bodies or robot links, essentially, because we want to describe the robot motion. Therefore, we need the position of the origin of the coordinate frame and its orientation. So we can do that by a frame. We call that a frame. Both positions and orientations can be represented by a set of four vectors. So we construct a frame, which is shown here, that frame B is a rotation matrix which describes its orientation with respect to some coordinate system of reference, which is A, and a vector which gives the position of the origin of this B with respect to again A. Okay, so this is a, this way we can have a position and orientation of the object in space, and we call this entity a frame. Or what we can do is, unfortunately this matrix is not appearing correctly, is basically it's a matrix in which you have a rotation matrix which is a 3 by 3 matrix, and you have the position vector AP B origin, and then you have a unit here and you have 3 zeros here. So this is basically the frame description, yeah, as a 4 by 4 matrix. Okay, so now we are going to actually talk about frames, and we are going to talk about transformation, and they are basically represented by a 4 by 4 matrix of the type that I just now showed you. It can have different interpretations. Interpretations are that you are describing a frame with respect to another that we saw. So we have this description here of frame B as I described, or we are talking about a transformation of a vector described in frame B as it would appear in frame A. So look at this, you have the green coordinate system here B, and there is a vector P which is described in this by this vector shown here. Now this vector, if you wanted to describe it in frame A, or this position P wanted to describe in frame A, then we will have to apply this transformation, okay, which is the same transformation, by the way, it's not a different transformation, we're talking about the same transformation, which is the transformation describing the rotation matrix of this coordinate system with respect to A and the location of its origin in the way that I described to you. So this transformation will, if you multiply a position vector known in coordinate system B with this transformation matrix, you will get a vector which is going to be the vector of point P as described in coordinate system A. Now of course I should make a note here, and you should, otherwise you'll catch me on that, is that this is a 4 by 4 matrix, so I have to now multiply a 4 by 1 vector to it. Okay, so of course I have my Px, Py, Pz, and then I am going to add a 1 at the, as a fourth element of the vector to make it consistent with the operations that I will be doing. Okay, it is interpreted as a scaling type of a quantity, but we will leave it as 1. We are not dealing with graphics where we use that, or other zero elements in the last row which have some interpretation, but we don't have to worry about that now. Okay, so this is coming back to this interpretation, that given a vector in a coordinate system, how it appears in another coordinate system is a very important task which we will be doing in robotics when we try to do motion analysis. One thing has to be remembered is that all operations, when we want to do operations, they must be referring to the same frame. Okay, so therefore if I wanted to write the position of point P in frame A, then it is actually not simply addition of these two, but you see, I take BP multiplied by the rotation matrix, so now that gives me the orientation of this vector in frame A, but to that I have to add the displacement which was there for the frame B. So but that is already known in frame A. So this type of thing, what you can think about this quantity here, that the leading subscript B is cancelling of the leading subscript of the next quantity, because both are P, that means it is known in A. Okay, this is a quantity which can be added to this quantity. We can't take some component in one coordinate system and some other component in another coordinate system and add them, they will be meaningless. So this is something that is taken care of in the transformation matrix that we are talking about. A third interpretation of this is that it translates a given vector by some, it translates and rotates by some given amount. So here is an example of that type of thing. If you look at this first 3 by 3 part of the matrix of the upper left hand side, it's basically, you can see it's a rotation of 30 degrees about the z-axis. Okay, so does everyone know how the rotation matrix looks like? Okay, just to make sure that everyone knows that, if I talk about rotation matrix, which is representing, yes, oh sorry, so rotation of about z axis by 30 degrees. Okay, this is going to be a 3 by 3 matrix, which is going to have cosine of 30 degrees minus sine of 30 degrees, sine of 30 degrees, cosine of 30 degrees, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay, this is a rotation matrix which is describing a rotation about z axis, that's why we have a 1 here, and it is by 30 degrees, so you have these elements which can be immediately known. Okay, if it is a rotation about x-axis, then this element, the first element, will become 1 and you will have non-zero items there. But notice that these are all unit vectors, if you look at the columns, because sine squared 30 plus cos squared 30 is unity. So that is essential, because rotation matrix has only 3 vectors which are unit vectors. Okay, so this interpretation is that you take a vector, say this one AP1 is shown in green, and then I'm applying a translation of some quantity 10 and 2 in the x and y direction, and I'm applying a rotation of 30 degrees, and then what happens to this vector is that this becomes the red vector. And this is what you will get if you multiply this vector by this matrix. Okay, so it represents a translation operation, and translation and rotation operation, or the previous interpretation was given a point in one coordinate frame, how it will appear in another coordinate frame, or simply the description of the coordinate frame. Okay, so with these same transformation matrix 4 by 4 is having a number of ways you can interpret it, and these are very convenient. Okay. So now if I have more than one such transformations, so if I had 3 reference frames here, so I have x, y, z here of C frame, I have x, y, z of B frame, and this is my A frame, then I can write a vector in C frame. Okay, this is the point that I am talking about, so this is the CP vector here. Now that will appear as BP vector, the green vector here, and that can be obtained simply by multiplying it with the transformation matrix between B and C. Similarly, you can cascade it and you can go down, and then you will find that by substituting for BP here in terms of what is known in the first line here, I can write this compound transformation matrix AC as a product of ABT and BCT. Okay, so they stack up nicely, they can multiply 4 by 4 matrices, and this is when you multiply it out again, the different version of the software seems to be doing this. These LL are supposed to be just 3 horizontal dots, and MM are vertical 3 dots, so it's just basically separating. I won't keep writing it because it will take too much time. So just imagine that this is a submatrix defining the submatrix like this into 4 submatrices. One is the rotation matrix 3 by 3, this is a vector 3 by 1 vector, this is a 1 by 3 vector of zeros, and this is a scalar quantity 1 here. Okay, so keeping that in mind, we will proceed with this thing rather than redrawing it on the paper. So when I multiply it out, these two, then the left hand side in the product is a 3 by 3 matrix submatrix, which is a product of the two rotation matrices. Okay, And here we have, oops,
the last column is 0, 0.
The last column,
the first and second matrix, the last column.
No, last column is not 0. Last column is a 3 by 1 vector, which is represented by that A, P, B origin. This is a vector quantity. Okay. So now this vector quantity here, it will be the multiplication of this row versus this column. Right. So this will give me A, B rotation matrix multiplied to B, P, C org. Okay. Plus 1 times this. So it's simply, you know, I'm writing some matrices, but you are multiplying it just like that. You write row versus column multiplication. So you can write the expression for a compound transformation, which is again a 4 by 4 matrix. Okay. If you want to find an inverse of a transform, which means we know B in A, but actually we wanted to know A in B. Right? So it is simply, if you want to have that, then B, with respect to B, the coordinate system A has a transformation T, which is nothing but the inverse of the transformation of B with respect to A. Okay? And we can find the inverse by simply finding the inverse of a 4 by 4 matrix, but it is not required, because actually it can be written in a much more compact way. Once again, think about this matrix as 4 submatrices. This is nothing but the transpose of the rotation matrix. Now, this is a property which you would have studied in maths, that if you have a matrix having unit vectors which are orthogonal, okay, then the inverse is nothing but the transpose. So this is nothing but the inverse of the rotation matrix in the first submatrix, but it is actually computed simply by taking the transpose. So you have to do no calculations, you just have to move the elements around. This is 0, 0, 0, this is 1. And this is basically BPA origin, meaning the origin of matrix A with respect to the coordinate system B. And that can be computed in a simple way also by taking the product of the transposed rotation matrix and the given vector which we have, with a minus sign. There is a minus sign which is kind of hidden. So this can be, again, you can derive this, we will not get into derivations of that. So the whole idea is that these transforms are, if we have a number of transforms describing one frame with respect to another frame, then you can write, if you have a loop, you can go from one transform to another transform in 2 different ways, then you can write an equation in terms of the transforms. Okay? So what I mean to say is, look at this diagram here. You have frame A, frame B, frame C in red, frame D in orange, frame E in purple. Okay? Now, the way the arrows are, I hope you can see the arrows, that this means that frame B is known in frame A because the arrow is pointing towards B. That means this is the vector A, P, B origin. Right? Similarly, this green here is the vector B, P, C origin, right? So you got that, very good. So now we can write, let's say we want to write transformation ACT, which is nothing but the product of ABT, this transformation, and BCT, okay, this transformation. But I can also get to it by the other route, which is going towards D. So ADT, DET, and ECT. So geometrically, it is much clearer. So I can write now, I have got 2 expressions for that transformation, and I equate that, so I have an equation. Now, if I want to find out some unknown quantity, something that is desired, say we wanted to know CET. Okay, now I have ECT here. So I can pre-multiply this quantity by the inverse of this product here on both sides. So that's what I do. So I take this product here of the first 2 quantities here, 2 matrices here, and take the inverse of that and pre-multiply it to this. That then I will get ECT. All right. Now, when you take the inverse, you can write the inverse of individual matrices in that product, but the order gets changed. This you have to remember. So it becomes DET inverse, which is this quantity here, times ADT inverse times these two quantities ABT and BCT. So now if these are all known, then this can be computed. Of course, we wanted the other way around, we wanted CET. So therefore, we have to take the inverse of the whole quantity, and then therefore again the order gets changed of the four matrices. So you get this expression here. Now here it was nice because my arrows was pointing in the right direction to get to that. In this diagram, it's not very clear, but this arrow is pointing this way, but this arrow is pointing this way. Okay. Similarly, this arrow is pointing this way, but this matrix D is known from frame E, and frame E is also defining C. So now it's all hodgepodge, there is no neat way, but there is no problem because we know the inverse will do the job for us. So if I want to write again ACT, then it is ABT, which is describing this coordinate system, and then because the arrow is the wrong way round, I have to take the inverse of the next one. So it becomes CB is known, but I take the inverse of that, so it becomes BCT essentially, right? So like that, I write another equation in terms of wherever the arrow is in the wrong direction, I take the inverse of the transform. And then I get another equation, and then again I can solve for the quantity of interest to me. Now why am I talking about this is because it represents the problem under consideration for us. Look at a typical situation. You have a robot here, its base is described by a transform or a frame B. Then you have the wrist, the position of the wrist. If that is known, then you may have holding a tool. So there is a tool frame which is known with respect to the wrist because you have attached to the wrist. It may be a gripper, it may be some kind of a grinding tool, or it could be deburring tool, or whatever it is. It is known with respect to the wrist. Similarly, where you fix a robot, with respect to that, the station, workstation coordinate is known, and you have in the workstation, you have the part where the job has to be done, maybe deburring has to be done, and this. So this is the goal frame. So this is the station frame, goal frame, base frame of the robot, wrist frame of the robot, and tool frame. Okay, these are standard names used for in robotics. So now I want to know I know where the goal point is from the base point, and I know it in two ways. I know it if I go through the robot, which means from base to wrist, wrist to tool, and tool to goal. And similarly, I can get to the goal by base to station, station to goal. And I equate the two, and I can solve for how my tool has to move. What is the transformation necessary? How much it should be displaced and how much it should be rotated? That's what I want to know so that I can do the job. So therefore, I want to know TG, okay? And this can be obtained by doing similar manipulations that we have talked about already. So this will give us. Now, of course, the question is, we have said that these are all known. Of course, between station and the base, it's known because it's fixed. Robot is fixed somewhere, station is fixed somewhere. Part is coming to a known location because of some conveyor or some feeding device or something, the part is known location and known orientation or whatever. Tool and wrist are known by some fixed kind of a relationship also. Only relationship that is not fixed is between the wrist and the base, which is the whole purpose of the robot, that we want to be able to take the wrist at different positions and orientations with respect to the base. So the question in front of us is, how do we know BWT, that is the transform between the base and the wrist? Okay, this is the forward kinematic problem that we are talking about. So we need to now develop a tool for doing this. The tool we are going to develop will be based on the geometry of the arrangement that we have in the robot from link to link. Okay, so now let's look at some kind of a general link. So I have link I minus 1, which is shown in the light blue color, and link I, which is shown in the pink color. Now, I have shown only the revolute joints here, but analysis is actually quite valid for prismatic joints also. Only thing is the direction of motion of the prismatic joint, the axis of the prismatic joint is taken as a z axis. So, but don't worry about that, let's first try to understand how it is, what we are doing for the revolute joints. So, for these two revolute joints, on link I minus 1, one is the axis I minus 1 and one is the axis I. The axis I is common to link I minus 1 and link I. So, any two consecutive links, there is an axis that is defined, which is defining the joint. Okay? Similarly, the previous, a link is nothing but having two joints. Now, a link can have more than two joints, we know that. But what in robotics we will do is, we will break apart the joint and we will say it's not one joint, then it's two joints. Coincident in one. Okay, so our purpose, it's sufficient to say that each link has two joints and each joint is connecting two links. So, in general, these two axes I minus 1 and I are not parallel because we are not talking about planar robots anymore. We are talking about general robots. So, they are not going to be parallel. They are going to be some two lines in space. They don't have to intersect either. However, between any two lines, whatever their orientation is, one can define a common normal which is normal to both of these lines. Okay? So, that is the line of interest to us. So, we draw that line between, which is the line which is perpendicular to both of these axes. Okay? Now, this we will take as the z-axis. The joint axis, and this line which is joining the two consecutive z axes, which is common, having a common normal, is going to be defining the x axis for us. So, this distance from the two axes on this line is a characteristic of the link. Okay, so we call that the link length. Okay, if the two axes were parallel, of course, it is the geometrical distance between the two, so there is no problem between the two joints, right? But when it is not, when you have a twist in the link, then this is the way we are going to define the link length. Okay, similarly, we define a twist. The twist I am going to define as a rotation about this line which is the normal to both of these axes, and if I take this axis I minus 1 and take it parallel and connect it here, then the rotation from I minus 1 to I about this x axis is going to give me the twist in the link. Okay? So, link twist is defined by the angle alpha, and link length is defined by a variable called variable or constant. It's constant here, of course, it's a. Yes, please. The alpha. Okay, so we already have a line which is uniquely defined for any two skew lines, which is the line which is normal to both. Okay, that is going to be our x-axis point going from I minus 1 link to I link. So, the direction of x-axis would be along this direction. Okay, now I am just taking this z-axis of the I minus 1 axis and parallelly taking it to the point where it is intersecting here. So, I am saying the angle which this translated line is making to this axis, because both are perpendicular to this line, right? That is the definition we said, that is the line joining both of these axes perpendicularly. So, therefore, I can uniquely know this rotation required to go from I minus 1 axis to ith axis about that x axis. Okay, so that rotation again is unique and it can be, it will define the twist in the link. So, we got two things now, physical link, we have a length and we have a twist. But we have to deal with a few more parameters yet.
Just extension of this, one twist is there in alpha.
Yeah.
Can there be another twist also?
This is the only twist. Only twist. Because of the way we defined it.
Which divine, okay, complete link, any twist.
Any arbitrary link of any shape, any geometry, anything, you'll be able to say one length and one.
Two rivulet joints for a parallel, perfectly parallel.
Yeah.
There is no requirement of.
This twist is zero. There.
One twist can be this way, another twist can be this way. So with this, only one twist.
Only one twist is required, yes. Because we are not talking about some fixed coordinate frame about whose axis we are saying how much rotation is there. And we are defining it with respect to this line which is normal to both the axes.
Common normal, so it will give only one twist.
Only one twist. Okay, now we look at the joint. We looked at the link. Now let us look at the joint. So look at this part here. We have axis I. Okay. And we have the next axis, I plus 1. So that is shown in the green line here. Of course, so now there is a common normal between I and I plus 1 also, which is shown by this line here. Okay, and this is the common normal between I minus 1 and I. So there are two parameters again here coming. One is this offset distance between the two along the ZI axis. Okay, again uniquely determined, and the rotation of the next x axis with respect to the previous axis about the same z axis. So you have the z axis and I translate this down here, then this rotation here from going from I minus 1, x I minus 1 to x I, which is this line here. So that is the joint angle. So you have two things here. You have the joint angle theta, which for, you know, planar thing, it's very easy to see. It's simply the rotation about the axis, which is same here. It's not difficult to see here either. So it is angle between xi and xi minus 1 about zi axis. And you have the joint offset d, which is the distance along the z axis going from I minus 1 to, so xi minus 1 to xi. Okay? So now for a revolute joint, what happens is that theta becomes our joint variable. This is the variable which we control in the robot. And for prismatic joint, this offset becomes the variable. So that is how much we are translating that particular joint by. Okay. So in summary, I have listed down all the definitions. This should have been alpha here, the second quantity. So it is AI is the distance from ZI to ZI plus 1 measured along XI. Alpha is the twist angle, which is the angle between ZI and ZI plus 1 measured along the XI axis. Offset, joint offset is the distance from XI minus 1 to XI measured along the ZI axis. And theta I is the angle between XI minus 1 and XI measured about ZI. This is not the only way to define these parameters, but this is one way to define the parameters. Okay, so I have taken the notation which the convention that Craig uses in his book on robotics. Now, so we talked about coordinate frames. We have already actually talked about that. So we have to establish the coordinate frames at the intersection of the z-axis and the common normal. So this is the ith coordinate frame. So I minus 1. This is I minus 1 axis. So zi minus 1 axis, xi minus 1 axis, and yi minus 1 must be chosen so that you get a right hand coordinate system. So as you go from x to y, the screw must move in the z direction. So that gives you the complete coordinate system. And similarly for the next axis, we have zi axis, xi and yi, all unit vectors shown here. Now, you can have a situation where the previous z axis and the next z axis, they intersect. We talked about the general case where they are two skewed line and they don't intersect, they are not parallel, right? So if they intersect, then you have a bit of a problem because the common normal is not a line but a point. So therefore, you have a choice of choosing the x direction, right? You will choose a x direction which is perpendicular to both of these, which is perpendicular to the plane defined by the two intersecting z axis. right? You can have a situation where one z axis is like this, another one is passing through it. So all you have to do is to choose a x direction which is perpendicular to both, either this way or that way. So you have a choice, two choices are there, going this way or that way. So this is a ambiguity, or you know, you'll have to choose one of the two. Okay. Now the convention is, we have to adopt a convention for the first and the last link, because there some of the things are free. So what is done is, for the base frame, which is the first frame, or zeroth frame, we call it zeroth frame or base frame, we make it so that we make the two frames coincidental, 0 and frame 1, when the joint variable is 0. So if it's a rotary revolute joint, then for 0 degree rotation, you make the two coordinate systems the same. Similarly, for the last frame, you choose, you try to make your xn minus 1 and xn coincidental for 0 joint variable. Okay, this is always possible to do. So this way we get one set of coordinate systems fixed to each of the links. Okay, and they are defined by 4 parameters: link length, link twist, joint rotation and joint offset. So if we prescribe these, then we have defined the geometry of the robot, and then we will be able to use this to do our forward kinematic calculation and analysis. So let's look at some examples to consolidate this heavy material. Okay, so let us look at a simple example of a planar 3 degree of freedom robot arm. So here we, I have not shown the z axis at all, they are all perpendicular to the plane. The zeroth frame here, first frame aligned to the, so how would we would have chosen? We would have chosen according to the same convention here, because all the z axes are parallel. So this line joining these two has to be the x axis, this is the common normal going from the first frame to the second frame in that direction. So z axis is out of the thing, so obviously y axis has to be perpendicular to this, like this, right? You come to this joint, once again same reasoning, you will get all these axes fixed to the links. And if you look at the parameters, alpha I minus 1, ai minus 1, din and theta I for I is equal to 1, 2, 3, then there is no twist in the links, okay? No displacement between the zeroth frame and the first frame, so that is 0, and there is no offset between the joints, okay? And only the theta 1 variable will come here as a joint variable between x0 and x1, let's say, about z0 or z1, yeah. So like that, if you do, then only things that will come is the link lengths, which are going to come as the parameter AIs, so A2, A1 and A2. Link length 3 is not coming to picture at all here in the parameters, because we are going up to the wrist. So what this length is, it's not making any difference, okay? So this is easy to see. Now let's see something a little more complicated. So we have here a simple robot in which the first axis of rotation is vertical axis and the second axis of rotation is horizontal axis, and then you have some link and some more axis, etc. Okay, but let's focus only on the first two, because here what I have tried to do is to illustrate the ambiguity which is there, the all different ways you can choose your coordinate system. So having chosen your x0, y0, z0, okay, x1, y1, z1 is coincidental with that, okay, but there are two ways we can choose that. You can choose the x-axis about this or that, okay. So there are the two cases which are there, and then in this case your z1 axis is here and z2 axis is here, because this is a rotary joint about a horizontal line. So this z2 axis passes through z1 axis. So you have a case where the two z axes are intersecting, and therefore the x-axis had to be perpendicular to that. So there are two perpendicular directions, x1 in that direction or x1 in this direction. Okay. Similarly, if you go to the next coordinate frame, then you have the possibility of choosing the x in two directions again. Okay, you have two parallel z-axis. So x2 is to be chosen in this direction, but you have the choice of choosing the z either in this direction or this direction. Okay, x2 is fixed. X2 has to go from previous link to the next link. But z, there is no clear cut thing. It depends on your preference what you consider as positive angle and what you consider as a negative angle. So in each case, one can find out these parameters. You have a question?
First case,
yeah.
X1 has to go in the direction of the link,
no? X1 has to go in the direct, it has to be along the common normal. The common normal between Z1 and Z2 can be either way because it's intersecting. So it is perpendicular to the plane which is defined by Z1 and Z2. So here it's, you know, there is an ambiguity. There is two directions you can choose. But it doesn't matter. You can choose one and then you can stick to that and everything will be fine. Because once you fix a coordinate system to that rigid body, then whatever rotation it does, the coordinate frame rotates with it. And your interpretation of what you're getting as a result, you have to apply your convention and know what you have actually chosen. Okay, here is another example where you have a prismatic joint. So you have one rotary joint here about a vertical axis. Then you have a sleeve here in which this whole body is moving in and out. And then you have also a revolute joint which is rotating about horizontal axis. Okay, so here if you fix the coordinate frames, so you'll have to, the 0 and 1 frame would be here. Your translatory axis has to be z axis here. Okay, and here the z axis is a rotation axis. So if I enlarge these coordinate frames here, then the first one is the revolute joint here, joint 1, which has the vertical axis. Z axis has to be vertical. This is the one that I was talking about, which is for the prismatic joint, which has to have Z2 horizontal. And Z3 has to be horizontal also because that is the axis of rotation of the third joint. Okay, so for choosing X axis in this direction, because again there is an ambiguity, Z1 and Z2 are intersecting, and therefore X1 has to be perpendicular to that plane defined by Z1 and Z2, and it's been chosen like this. Having chosen that, after that, you have to choose ZX2 in this direction, and you can find out the joint parameters here, the link joint parameters, which define the whole geometry. Once you've gotten this, after that, it's all maths. Okay, so shall we look at any of these? Or these are just basically the way I have defined them, you have to interpret that, look at that carefully, but you should go through the exercise if you want to understand it. Okay, so now look at something more realistic. You have the Puma industrial robot. Okay, 6 degrees of freedom, articulate type, meaning all revolute axis, and electric actuation. It has some weight capacity and some accuracy, etc., etc. But it's a realistic robot. So if you look at that now, the schematic of the robot is shown here. The first axis is about the vertical axis, the second is about a horizontal axis, okay, which is that the whole thing rotates like this, and then the next one is the arm moves about a horizontal axis, and then you have an elbow, so another axis which is horizontal here. So Z2 is coincidental with, you know, and located at the same point but not oriented in the same way, because Z1 has to point up, whereas Z2 has to point horizontally, but it is located in the same place here. Okay, it wasn't essential, it could have been located here for example, but the manufacturers have used this, and so that is, most people are using that, it has some advantages. So going next joint, you have Z3 axis like this, and X3 has to be pointing away, going from Z2 to Z3. Okay, now the next three joints are all located at one point, because that wrist has three rotations, and therefore they are shown by three separate coordinate systems, but they are supposed to be located at the same point. Therefore, okay, but so there the various parameters for this can be defined according to the definitions, and one can see that between 0 and 1, the base frame and the first joint, it is simply the theta 1 rotation. Theta 2 should have been there. Okay, so this is a mistake in here. This should have been theta 2. Okay, and so on and so forth. So various offsets are defined, and these offsets get reflected in the parameters. Okay, so now having known these parameters, how do we get the transformation? Because transformation is what we want. Once we have transformations, then I can find out the transformation between the base and the wrist. That's what I need, right? This is, we are doing all this so that we will be able to compute that transformation. So for that, we need to know how from one link to the next link, what is the transformation? And that transformation can be defined in terms of the four parameters that we have, one variable and three parameters. Okay, so how do we do that? Now let us understand that. So we have the two links here, and my red coordinate system here is xi, yi, zi, and the blue coordinate system here is xi minus 1, yi minus 1, zi minus 1. Okay, this is what we had talked about earlier. So these are the same two coordinate systems defined in the same way, located in the same way. Now what I do is I define a whole lot of intermediate coordinate systems to understand how the transformation will be. So look at the coordinate system P, which is shown in green. It is oriented the same way as I. It's only displaced by the offset amount. Okay, the joint offset amount it is displaced by. So now it is now located here, but oriented the same way as the ith frame. Similarly, now I go to next is Q frame. Now Q frame is shown in yellowish color or orange color, and it is located at the same point. The origin is at the same point. Z axis is in the same direction, but it is rotated about the ZI axis or ZQ axis by the theta I amount. Okay, so now if you look at the XP axis, which was the axis of the IP also, sorry, XI also, and XQ, they are rotated so that this XQ is now become aligned with the X axis here. Okay, now between Q and R, which is shown in light blue color, it's simply a translation. You take this whole coordinate frame and you now translate it by this amount to bring it here. So you have Q and R. So this is XR, YR and ZR. And between XR, YR and ZR and XI minus 1, YI minus 1, ZI minus 1, there is only a rotation of the twist of the link. So now what we have done is we have defined these intermediate PQR frames, so that between any of these two, there is only one change of one rotation or one translation. Now those rotations and translations of one axis, I know how to write it down. I have written it down for you, like for X axis, Y axis, Z axis, and these are rotations about Z axis and X axis, and translations about some axis. So translation is simply the last column, the three elements on the top, that is the translation. And rotation is the rotation matrix. So for each of these, I can find the transformations. And therefore, I can write this, given any vector in frame I, if I want to know how it will look in frame I minus 1, then I have to multiply it by these transformations, I minus 1 R transformation, RQ transformation, QP transformation, PI transformation. And each of these transformations is simple because they have, as I said, only one change. Okay, either some angle rotation or, and in fact it's precisely this, this between, there is a z, about z you have a translation by amount the offset, joint offset. You have a rotation about the zi axis by theta I. You have a translation about the xi axis by a minus, ai minus 1, which is this distance here. And you have a rotation about the x axis by the link twist angle. If you do these, then you are actually going to get the entire transformation, and which when you multiply it out comes out to be what is shown here. The convention here is that c theta I is cosine of theta I and s theta I is sine of theta I. So this here, this term here, for example, is cosine theta I times cosine alpha I minus 1. So all these quantities are known except of course one quantity, which is the joint angle, which is known from at each time, or at this instant of time this is the joint angle. So at any instant of time we know all these things, we can compute this in numerically and get a 4 by 4 matrix, which is set of numbers known to me. Okay, so then what we can do is, knowing all the link parameters, so for the Puma robot for example, all the link parameters are known and all these transformation matrix can be computed. So for example, look at the first one, first joint. You have all these quantities, parameters are 0, only theta 1 is there. And since theta 1 is there, which is a rotation about the z axis, therefore I have a transformation matrix which is simply a rotation matrix of this type. Similarly, if you look at the second one, you have alpha I minus 1, which is non-zero, and theta 2. So if I go back, then I have to substitute for the all those parameters here and I will get a transformation matrix which will look like this. Now it's not a pure rotation about y axis because there is a twist coming in here. Okay, therefore it is not coinciding with what I would have expected for just a rotation about x axis or y axis. So it is something more, but you can see that all these columns are unit vectors, which must be so in the rotation matrix, and there is no translation here. The moment I will have some kind of offsets here, then these numbers also come in here in the last column, which is representing translations and offsets, right? So this is, now you have understood that given any robot geometry, the way the link is, the way the joints are, we can compute these four parameters by looking, you know, without getting confused. But it can be done, you can master it, it's not difficult. And then once we know these four parameters, we can find out the transformation matrix between every joint. And all I can do is, I have all these going from 1 to 2, 1 to 0 to 1, 1 to 2 and 5 to 6. If I want to know what my gripper, I have a vector, let's say there is a tool, the tool frame, which is defined by, let's say, a vector there. How that is oriented in the third joint, if I want to know that, then I have to multiply these three matrices together. And I'll get a description of that vector in the coordinate frame of the third joint. Or if I want to know how it looks in the world frame, I have to go down to the zeroth frame. And I multiply all these six axes and I get the compound transformation matrix which will describe the tool in the base frame, right? So this is what basically is forward kinematic analysis. Okay, it's difficult when you try to do the problems, there's a lot of computations. I'm not saying it's easy, but at least you have a handle on it, you understand how it is done, then you can sit down and spend enough time and you can, for any robot actually, you can do it. So let us look at the inverse problem. Okay, as I said, the inverse problem is, given you have the wrist position and orientation is given, you want to know what the joint should be. So I am taking a very simple example here because we won't have time to do, and there is no need to subject you to that. right now, is basically, so in this planar problem, you have all z axes are coming out of the plane, and you have three joint variables, all revolute joints, theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, and the link parameters are what we had found out earlier, are listed here. So what we do is, we can find the compound transformation from the base to the wrist. I can do that by multiplying that, and then, so I multiply the three transformation matrices which I'll get from corresponding to the three rows of this, right? So 0, 1, t, 1, 2, t, 2, 3, t, which will be gotten from there by using the general formula for defining the link transformation. So multiplying them all together, I get a matrix like this, okay, which is showing the cosine of theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3, sine of theta 2, you know. So this part, actually you should be able to, you should have guessed it, because what is the orientation of the wrist?
Theta 1 plus theta 2.
It's nothing but theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3, whichever way it is, that is how the wrist is going to be oriented. There is no other way the wrist can be oriented. So that's what our, fortunately our matrix multiplication is also showing the same. So you can always have a check like this and see. Now the location of the thing is also, is not very difficult to see in this particular case. One could have derived it from the geometry very easily using trigonometry, but this can be done by transformation matrices. Okay. The way we have to do the problem is that we are given the wrist position and orientation. So what we are given is, what we specified is this matrix here. Okay, x, y location of the wrist point and some orientation of the wrist, phi. So from that I can find the rotation matrix, and the rotation matrix is cosine phi minus sine phi, sine phi cosine phi, and 1. So this part is the rotation matrix about the z axis, okay, by phi amount, and this is the translation amount, which is the position of the wrist with respect to the base frame. If this is specified, what I can do is, I can compare various quantities here and here and write equations, algebraic equations or trigonometric equations here. So for example, I can say that cosine of theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3 is cosine of phi, and sine of theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3 is sine of phi. I can determine from that phi is nothing but theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3. Okay? Or I can look at these two quantities x and y. X equals to L1 cosine theta 1 plus L2 cosine theta 1 plus theta 2, and y is equal to L1 sine 1 plus L2 sine theta 1 theta 1 plus theta 2. So I have two equations now, and I have two unknowns, theta 1 and theta 2, and I can solve for it. No, but in these equations there are only two unknowns, theta 1 and theta 2, right? And I have two knowns, x and y is specified for me, the link parameters are known to me, L1 and L2. So therefore, it's a question of solving them. What one will have to do in this case is that you have to take the square of each of the equations, add them together, you will basically get the cosine formula, right? And then one will have to juggle around, and you will get the solution to all the angles, theta 1, theta 2 from here, and then knowing the sum of the 3 as phi, we can find out theta 3. Okay, now in general, this is what we will have to do. You have, for any robot, the end wrist position and orientation are being given to you. Okay, so you will be able to find the product of that, the six transformation matrix, and equate it to the desired position and orientation matrix that you are desiring, the frame that you are desiring. Okay, and you will compare these things, and you will try to solve these transcendental equations which will be coming. Basically, trigonometric functions are there, and one will have to find ways. There are, once you start doing it, you get to know what the techniques you should be using. But in general, you can only have numerical solution. You can have analytical solution only when there are three, no, I shouldn't say only when. You are guaranteed that you have an analytical solution if three axes in the robot pass through a single point. Now this is why, if you go back to the Puma robot, the last three axes were at the same point. they were intersecting axes. So if the last three axes are always passing through a point, then there is a way to, given by Piper, there was somebody, Piper, who solved the general case when three intersecting axes that are there, how to get the inverse solution in a closed form. If three axes are not intersecting, then they may be or may not be. Okay? So in all commercially available robots, usually the last three axes are intersecting, and this allows you to solve. So what we do is we solve for the position, and then we can solve for the last three axes using Euler angle expressions. So as a general way, if you look at Puma, for example, then you this is what you will know. You want some orientation, which means you know some rotation matrix given here, and you have the wrist position. So these are known, and this is equal to a matrix which has got these expressions. This R11 is this, which is now in this, it has been further compacted. This is cosine of theta 1, cosine of theta 2 plus theta 3 is written as C23. The cosine of theta 4 times cosine of theta 5 times cotine of theta 6 minus sine of theta 4, sine of theta 6, etc., etc., etc. So they are long complex expressions, but there are some simpler expressions also. So you will correspondingly, you will, from the given element that you know the numerical value for, you will compare it with say these two, and then adding, subtracting, you may be able to get rid of some terms. Taking ratios, you may be able to get rid of some terms. Or in the case of Puma, the way it works is that there is a technique you can adopt, which is that given this overall transformation for the robot from base to wrist, this is consisting of product of six transformations. Each is a function of one of the angles. Okay, so if I take this overall transformation and multiply it by the inverse of the first matrix, then on the right hand side I'll get 1 6, which is a product of these five terms here. On the left hand side I have this known matrix, which is the what I want, and this is the unknown theta 1 here, right? Now as it happens, if you actually multiply out matrix 1 2 2 3 2 3 4 5 6, then you will get some expression there. And it happens so that the element 2 4, okay, which is turns out to be D3 only. So D3 is known. If D3 is known, I can equate the unknown expression here, which happens to be sine of theta 1 times Px given quantity plus cosine of theta 1 times Py. So I have been able to write an equation by simply looking at the elements, which elements to compare, because there are so many elements. In fact, there is a redundancy of elements. So if I equate that, then I have only unknown is theta 1 here. Okay, and then so you are isolating each of these variables, because each of these transformation matrix is only depending on one, and this product is known because that is the desired position and orientation. And by pre-multiplying by the inverse of one of these, you are separating that variable out of the other variables. If I had simply multiplied out, they will all be clumps of mixtures of various variables. But I have isolated it by pre-multiplying it on the left hand side and multiplying it to the desired orientation, you know, transform, and isolated that and managed to solve it. Okay, so like that one can do, and one can find the solution. It comes out to be a very complex solution, but it's doable. So that is all I think I should talk about. Wanted to give you a flavor of what the problems look like in kinematics and inverse kinematics. Actual solutions, you know, the approaches are there, and then one will have to do the hard work for actually doing any of these.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us more about
it? Well, bond graph is a way of modeling. right? So it could be any way of modeling, it doesn't have to be bond graphs. The package, which is the Cosmo package or whatever that is developed at IIT Kharagpur, it's, I think they must have found some way of using it. But
it takes care of the multiple system and combine it, but I don't think this inverse kinematic can be done by the bond graph.
Because inverse kinematic problem in general is not solvable in a closed form. Only numerically it can be solved,
no,
in general.
Forward
kinematics, yeah, it is possible.
Basically, the system is totally different than that model. Bond graph is taking care of the multiple dimensional system.
The arm example that we have taken.
Yeah.
In that, yes, clearly calculated.
No, I am not saying that it is not possible to do it. It is very possible to do it in that. Okay, because you have to define all these transformer fields and gyrator fields and the zeros and one junctions and all that. It is not very, very straightforward for rigid body dynamics. For lump parameter systems, you know, of spring mass dashpot, that scheme is very good, especially when you have electrical system, mechanical systems, rotational systems, other systems all combined, you know, in a multi-domain type of situation, bond graphs are very useful. And bond graphs help you in modeling in some way because they have the concept of causality. And there are various checks and balances, whether you're doing it right or wrong, it helps you to do that. But it's not necessary.
Just to simplify the whole.
Okay, if it's simpler to you, then by all means you should, you know, look at that. I have not really looked at that particular solution, so I can't comment on that.
This doubt is basically the computational, so much computation, like predefined trajectory to follow.
No, it's the same thing now. Teach path meaning you already know the joint angles.
So basically they are sequentially recorded.
Yeah.
And then you follow. But when you say this, suppose drawing a straight line.
This depends on the task. In many places you can do teaching is not that simple if you have lots and lots of points. For example, palette application and all that. If palette has 100 parts in it,
okay,
you have to go to each part and you have to teach it, it's not very good. Then you would like to know, say, okay, x direction offset is so much, y direction offset is so much, palette corner is here, all 100 points can be generated.
Oh, that is by indexing, sir.
Yeah, that's right. So there you would like to use inverse kinematics. And nowadays, I mean, yes, 20 years ago when, 30 years ago when these things were, you know, just being demonstrated, the first robots were being demonstrated, that time computation power and today's computation power, there's a vast difference. So computation is not as much of an issue as it used to be. It is still an issue because you want to do in real time, you want to do as fast as possible so that your robot is fast. But it is not as much of an issue.